Welcome to the webinar on digital signal processing. We will be looking at the fundamentals of this very vast and extremely interesting subject and how they relate to practical applications in different fields and also career paths in those fields. Basically, in today's session, we'll be taking an introduction and also a complete overview of the subject. We'll be looking at some basic fundamentals, and I have picked up some fundamentals which are relevant to the use cases that we'll be looking at. We'll be looking at some case studies and finish off with state of the art and evolution in the field. And of course, the most interesting part, what are the options for career paths? So with that, we know that signals are all around us. So they are a description of something that happens in nature. They can be, those are naturally generated signals, or they are something that are generated synthetically through some man-made process. And now with the explosion in communication and entertainment, there is a whole variety of signals that are created. So signal typically represents at least one physical quantity, which varies over time or space or both. So let me just give an example. If you consider temperature in a city, so that will be one single quantity varying over time. On the other hand, if you have a video signal corresponding to a movie, then basically we will have at least three color channels. So we have the red, green, and blue channels, which are varying over space. So basically pixel values across the image. So there will be an X and Y coordinate there. And they will also be varying across time. So this is an example of a multidimensional signal. And there are a lot of techniques to handle those. And in basically signal processing, so all of this overview and all that we will be looking involves two basic operations. One is changing the properties of a signal or extracting information from it. So by changing the properties of a signal, so maybe an example could be cleaning up noise from a speech signal, could be an example. Extracting information from a signal, so I will give a very common and very prevalent use case, and that is our Amazon Echo devices, which use Alexa voice services. So basically, whatever we speak, that will be parsed out for useful information, which the device will interpret as a query or a command. So we have a use case for that. So let's just get started. Digital signal versus analog signal. So this is a very commonplace usage, but we need to understand that digital and analog differ from two different aspects. So when we have an analog signal, so it is a continuous time signal. So over here, at every time instant, you will have a corresponding value. So the first step towards digitalizing a signal is make it discrete time. So the signal will be defined only at certain intervals. And some texts and research papers also refer to it as lollipop notation. So you can see this in figure 3. So basically, there's a signal value, and then there will be a stick with the signal point, and the sticks represent the time duration of sampling. So we know that this time interval that we pick for creating the discrete time samples is very important to retain the character of the signal. The second step is basically discretization of the amplitude levels. So here again, the amplitude can be any value. So if I just take these two dotted horizontal lines, so it can be anything in between. But when we come to the digital domain, we constrain the amplitude to one out of some fixed levels. So how do those fixed levels come? They come from the word depth, or what is known as bit depth. So in this case, we are using 3 bits to represent a single sample. So 3 bits meaning 2^3 and n levels. So this is again very basic. I think we all know that, but it is important to know that this discretization happens both on the x-axis and y-axis. So just to re-emphasize that. Now, why is a digital representation better? So we always, any text which talks about this will start off with digital signals are more tolerant towards noise. So basically what this means is that because our levels are fixed, we cannot have intermediate values. If there is a small distortion of a level, we can still map it to its original level. So for example, the voltage difference between 0 and 1 will be quite significant because you don't have a 0.5, 0.6, 0.7 levels. So basically, if your bit 1 dropped down to 0.9 or your bit 0 slightly went up by 0.1, you're still okay. So that is why the digital signals are considered more tolerant to noise. Then the other property is error correction techniques, which is used to detect and correct bit errors during transmission. So basically what can happen is if I have a string of say 8 bits and then I can add a few more bits as an error correction. So common schemes are checksum, and then you can have some more advanced coding schemes like Reed-Solomon codes, which are used, and especially in the area of communications, it is used very heavily because when you receive a packet over the internet, you run some checksum and you get a fail, then either you can reject that packet and ask for it to be resent. So there are a lot of schemes that come in the picture at that time, but this is possible only with digital. Another important thing is easy storage on digital media. So to explain that, I will give the example of those old vinyl records. I don't think many of you might have seen or used them now, but basically they were used to store and play out music. So in this case, everything from the way of recording to the way of storage, that is the vinyl itself, to the playout was all tightly coupled. You could not store some other data, for example, temperature data in a city, on a medium like that. So the medium was used only for, you know, audio data. Now, in today's situation, we don't have such constraints. So we can store any kind of digital data on any digital medium. So that is an easy storage. Then also packetization and transmitting over a network. So at a time, we can say do 1024 bytes, make it one packet, add the error correction, add the header information, add the destination information to be able to route it over our IP networks. So all this is possible with digital. Imagine doing it over an analog signal. No, that's not possible. Then next, we have an ability to multiplex multiple channels. So earlier, I spoke about the red, green, and blue, the RGB channels for a video signal. So this is one example. Then another could be the left and right channels in audio. Another example could be our Dolby surround sound, 5.1 channels and growing. So that number is growing. We can also have multiple television channels over HDMI. So there are many different use cases where we need to multiplex multiple channels. And all of this is possible in a digital representation. We can also have the ability to design and implement signal processing algorithms and data compression techniques. So basically in data compression, we are able to reduce the amount of data that we need to transmit or store by utilizing certain properties and redundancies in that data. So again, this is possible in the digital domain only. So with this overview, let us just quickly recap the basic operations that are done on signals. So one thing we know is that a signal can be viewed as a weighted addition of multiple sine waves, that is a sine wave decomposition. Then we can add signals together. So for example, we can add the recordings from several microphones together. And we can also multiply a signal by a constant. So that is scaling or gain or volume. So there are many such operations possible. Then coming to a little more interesting stuff on the X domain. So in this case, it is possible to time shift a signal. So either we can delay a signal or advance a signal. So we have seen this in the basic text. So applications for this is when we want to time align some signals. We can also change the periodicity of a signal. So basically, we can stretch the signal in the time domain, or we can compress the signal in the time domain. And this is also the field of sample rate conversion. Sample rate conversion has many applications because in complex equipment, or when you have many different components in a chain, you can have each component having its own sampling frequency. So rate conversion becomes important. Now we'll move on to convolution. So convolution, again, very important. I think all of us have, it's one of the starting points of any DSP study. So basically, we know how to compute the output y of n given a filter response h of n and an input x of n. So one practical example which I would like to show is edge detection in images. So basically, over here, this is my filter or a convolutional filter which is used to detect a vertical edge. So in this case, I will have a string of negative ones and then zero and then positive ones. Now, if you look at an image, so there will be, so this is a gray image, the famous Lena image for simplicity. So let us assume this is the edge in question that we want to talk about. So what will happen? We'll just move on to another slide. So basically, if I consider this 3x3 filter grid, so we know that to convolve an image, we will need to basically move this filter grid all over the image and then do a computation on that. So when we are moving the filter grid over an area which is having the same intensity, so let's just assume, let's ignore this minor changes and look at the same intensity. Over here, I will get the same value. Similarly, in this region, which is having the same pixel values, I will get the same value. Now, if I, when I place this 3x3 grid over a region which represents an edge, at that time, I will see that my value will change because this part of the image, the lighter part of the image, is getting multiplied by minus one values. And the darker part is getting multiplied by positive one. So depending on which one, how we have assigned the brightness levels on this image, we will get some value for the convolutional filter output at this point. And that is what will tell us about the edge. So if I just go over here, so we will be able to recognize the vertical edges using this filter. Similarly, filter coefficients like this will help us detect the horizontal edges, and then we can combine combinations of filters in order to get all the rest of the edges in a image. But the basic concept of any edge detection comes to this. Now, this concept is very heavily used in all sorts of image processing applications and deep neural networks. So we have the whole topic of convolutional neural networks, which basically starts off from here. Now, what is the advantage of such a filter-based approach? So basically, when we are given an image, we don't know where the edges are. And more importantly, the edges can be of any size. Like for example, we have a very long vertical edge here, but we could also have some smaller vertical edges in some different corners and you know, things like that. So in this case, we will be able to detect all of those edges using this same filter. Absolutely no issue or no scale, or no other considerations to be used. Hence, and this makes convolutional filtering a very powerful tool. Our next concept is the sampling frequency. As I said in the initial part, when we talked about the discrete time signals, the size of the sampling duration is important. Now, why? And that is only because we want to be able to retain the character of the signal. So for example, now I have three diagrams of the same sine wave. So this is the same frequency, the one in black. And I'm going to sample it using different intervals. So these yellow dots represent my sampling durations. And then once I have sampled them, then I no longer have any knowledge about the black lines. So they will go away. And then I'm just left with the yellow dots. And then from there, I try to guess what was the original signal. And you can see in all the three cases, I have not got the blue, the black line back. So that means I have lost the character of the original signal. And this is an aliasing effect. So aliasing effect manifests as the signal of having a different frequency. So coming to frequency domain representation, again, another very important topic. So as we know, we have three sine waves and then we can see them in the frequency domain. Their relative amplitudes have also been captured on the frequency domain representation. So here what I have done is I have used the Audacity tool. It is a free, easy, and extremely easy to use tool. You can use it both on Ubuntu as well as Windows. So on this, I have just taken a voice recording and taken one, just selected approximately one, around 1.5 seconds from it. And I have taken a frequency domain just to illustrate. So this is a simple case, three sine waves, very straightforward frequency domain. This is more like a real world use case. In this case, you can see the speech frequencies will be present, and then you can see their relative components. And one more thing to note in this graph is the x-axis, frequency axis, has been put on the log scale. Of course, we could change it in the tool, but I kept it intentionally as a log scale just to bring the point that in many frequency domain representations, we will see it this way. And this mimics the human ear, and particularly when we are extracting speech frequencies for speech recognition, we'll be using the log scale. So that's the practical real world implication of that. So benefits of frequency domain representation. So first, this will be a typical path for it. So we'll have an input signal, and then we'll be going from the time domain to the frequency domain transformation, and then whatever processing we want to run in the frequency domain, and then back to time domain. So if you have an FFT here, you'll have an inverse transform, inverse FFT here, and then finally the output signal to be played out or viewed or stored. So basically, the frequency domain will lead to a compact representation. So rather than storing each and every sample, we will be storing the relative weights of the different frequencies, and hence fewer coefficients will be needed. So we will be able to enhance the frequencies as per the bands. So some frequency bands may be needed to be handled differently. Like, for example, if we are in an automotive application, so somebody is driving a car and you want that person's voice to be picked up and enhanced, because as we know, cars are very noisy environments because of the engine noise. So if knowledge of the engine noise frequencies and knowledge of what is our speech frequencies will help us to handle frequency bands differently, and that will give more intuitive filtering, and which will help in our final use cases. The next topic is filtering. So filtering will basically modify the spectrum of the input signal. And then when we talk of filtering, we have the FIR and IIR filters, the finite impulse response and infinite impulse response. That itself is a topic, another vast topic. But suffice to say that one example of it could be like a graphic equalizer. So in equalizer also, we will be doing a filtering on the signal. And I have chosen a graphic equalizer, which has these slider controls, because it is something that is very easy to use. You can see it on DJ consoles also. Some form of it will be on DJ consoles. So in this case, again, this is a screenshot from the Audacity tool. And then we can move these sliders up and down in order to manipulate our response. And even some graphic equalizers will be there which will have fewer frequencies. Like in this case, they have gone all the way from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, which is the full range of human hearing. But typically some 5 slider controls is more common and will be found on even some simpler equipment. And just to conclude on the spectrum or the filter or the frequency response, this is very important from a final application perspective, because many manufacturers of equipment or microphone manufacturers, or if you pick up a spec sheet of a speaker, they will always have a frequency response included in that. So that is very practically relevant. Then we move on to correlation. So correlation again answers two questions, basically the operation of correlation. So given two signals, how much are those two signals alike? How much are they similar to each other? And then if the signals are alike, or they may even be identical, is there a time delay between them, that if you, compensate for that time delay, then the addition of those signals will be maximum? So these points are answered by the correlation operation. Now, autocorrelation is used to find out the fundamental frequency or time period of a single signal. And in case of cross-correlation, we will be comparing signals from two sources. So they could be left and right channels, or they could be if you have two antennas which are picking up signals. So when we compare those two, so that will be cross correlation. Now, what will be the applications of this? So two or more sensors will acquire a signal. Then we use the correlation operation. Using the result of the time lag, the sign and the magnitude of that time lag, we can time align these two sensor outputs and get a combined signal which will have higher sensitivity. And this is used in the radar applications. Another application of it is direction finding. So before we go to microphone arrays, we should take a step back and think about our own ears. So human ears are very good at finding the direction and also distance of a particular sound source. So even if you close your ears and you are just listening, you can make out from which direction the sound is coming. So that is because the human brain uses the time delay between the signal that arrives at one ear versus the signal that arrives at the second ear. So basically in our applications, if we have two microphones, we can do a cross correlation on those two signals, and then we can find the direction. Quantization is also one more fundamental concept. So quantization helps us to increase the accuracy of a representation. So like I had said, the discretization of a signal happens in the amplitude level also. So if we just take a look here, so the blue outline, which is here, this light blue outline, represents the original signal, and the pink line represents the quantized signal. So as we can see, there are some small differences which we can depict in this, again, lighter pink line, which is hopefully having a small level. So why does this happen? Why are the blue and pink lines not exactly the same? That is because we have a limited number of bits to represent our digital data. And then because, say, we have only n bits, so we can only have 2 to the power n levels. And so there will be a limitation. So how to make this representation better? How to make the pink line as close as possible to the blue line? One is increase the word length and also increase the sampling frequency, because then your samples will come closer to each other.